I have been informed that the whippery has agreed that there will be no notices of motions or motions without notice. I would like to, as we proceed, Honorable Chetty, as we proceed, I would like to take this opportunity to welcome our ministers and deputy ministers, and also take this opportunity to alert this Honorable House that we are aware that the members of the National Assembly might be required in their house at a particular time, that we can assure you that we have made arrangements to be alerted and to be able to suspend our business and give the honorable members enough time to get to that house until they have finished to come back to us. Members, I therefore now take the opportunity to call on the Honorable Minister, the Honorable Pando, to begin with the questions. The Honorable Minister, Minister Pando.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Chairperson, I'm answering question 217. Mm-hmm. The reply, I must begin by informing honourable members that not all science councils reside under the administration of the Department of Science and Technology. We do have institutions that are administered by departments, and the Council for Geoscience is an entity that is accountable to the Department of Mineral Resources. But the role that we play with respect to the various science entities is to conduct independent studies to assess the state of research and technological capacity of the research bodies and provide decision makers with a report on priorities regarding modernization of infrastructure, technology enhancement, as well as human capital development requirements. We carried out such a study in the year, beginning in the year 2010. It was a partnership between ourselves, science and technology, the Council for Geoscience, as well as the Department of Mineral Resources, the responsible department. We produced a report which was titled Overview of the Council for Geosciences. It was published in 2011 and provided an assessment of the Council's research and technological capacity. The report identified a lot of deficiencies which we believe needed to be addressed over a period of time. And we developed recommendations aimed at introducing appropriate interventions. The deficiencies included the fact that the infrastructure and equipment of the council was more than 20 years old, and that they needed recapitalization, and that the building hosting the analytical laboratory needed very, very major refurbishment. It had already been declared unsafe by inspectors. We also said, although the council had the necessary skills to operate specialized equipment, the skills could be lost if we didn't have the necessary upgrading. We were fortunate in that National Treasury had by that time, Chairperson, introduced what we call the National Treasury Economic Competitiveness Package. And from that budget item, we were able to secure 200 million rand through mineral resources in 2012 for a 3-year refurbishment and modernization upgrade to the council. This began to be implemented from April 2012, and its conclusion date is 31st March 2015. It's an update of the laboratory equipment and the infrastructure of the council, and any detail with respect to work being done can be sourced from the Department of Mineral Resources. Thank you very much, Chairperson.
Thank you, Honourable Minister. The Honourable Member who posed the question, did she make arrangements? Honourable Smith.
Thank you, Honourable Chairperson. What will the department do about the aging infrastructure at the Council of Geoscience and Onderstepoort Biological Products as a hamper to entities' ability to play its role in realizing the aspirations of the National Development Plan, balancing their developmental and commercial mandates, and attract, train and retain critical scientific skills?
Honourable Minister.
Thank you, Honourable Member. Well, with respect to the Council for Geoscience, I've answered that there's a three-year process underway. With respect to Onderstepoort, that is a responsibility of the Department of Agriculture, Forestry and Fisheries, but I am aware that the Minister has taken a very direct interest in improving the research capabilities of the sector and is giving attention to Onderstepoort. In fact, he's already visited it, and I believe will be providing some funding in order to enhance its research capabilities. We are involved in a number of bilateral joint initiatives with DST and the Department of Agriculture, Forestry and Fisheries, and I'm sure we're going to see a new life in the research facilities of agriculture.
Honourable Minister, Honourable Members, any other follow-up? None. Honourable Minister, we proceed to the next question.
Thank you again, Chairperson.
Question 228.
This is question 228 that I'm responding to. And just to report that with respect to employees at the SKA project, we employ 18 astronomers. 12 of the 18 are South African citizens. 6 out of the 18 are foreign nationals who are all senior scientists, and several of them have indicated they wish to spend a very long time working in South Africa due to excitement about the project. We also employ many other South African scientists as well as engineers as part of the engineering team. And all the infrastructure design and development teams are led by South African scientists and engineers. With respect to bursaries, thus far we've awarded 612 grants and bursaries for postdoctoral fellows, postgraduate students at master's and honors level, and undergraduate students pursuing science, engineering, and technical degrees. All of these bursaries are honored at universities, as well as universities of technology in South Africa. We've also funded 300 students to follow artisan courses so that we have technologists to work on the big project. 450 of the students currently supported out of the 612 are South Africans. 114 are from the rest of the African continent, and 46 are from outside Africa. Of the South African students supported, over 57% are black students. The bursary support program will be continued with the intention of attracting more black candidates to study to work on the program. Thank you, Chairperson.
Thank you, Minister. The Honorable Mukwena is not in the house. I do not see anybody standing up to take that space. It means, Honourable Member, that the first is gone. Is there any other member who wishes to do a follow-up? None. Minister, we proceed to question 233. And again, I must point out, Honourable Minister, that Honourable Matiebas is also not in the house. Now, I have just been refreshing myself on the rules. Rule 246, 1-5 says, if a member does not rise for the question for oral reply, standing in that member's name, that question lapses unless the person who is to reply to the question elects to reply. Now, usually members make arrangements within their parties, and that is why we have somebody standing. So there is no Mr. Mukwena, there is no Mr. Matiebas, there is, however, Mr. Vauda. I don't know if Mr. Vauda has been thoroughly briefed to deal with this question. But let me give you the opportunity, Minister.
Chairperson, the answer is a very long reply, but I do think it's an important response. I would want to begin by saying that government doesn't have individual departmental industrial plans. Our plans emanate from government-agreed documents, such as the industrial policy action plan, which is IPAP, as well as the National Development Plan. IPAP is coordinated by the Department of Trade and Industry, and several departments play a role in executing the key objectives of IPAP. As science and technology, we respond to three key development opportunities in the Industrial Policy Action Plan, which interestingly are also mirrored in the National Development Plan. These are building new industries, secondly, improving the competitiveness of existing industries through using technology, and providing technology support to small and medium enterprises. In the area of new industry, we of course really initiate a lot of research in a range of domains. With respect to this particular year, we are focused on advancing our portfolio of projects, including projects focused on the production of titanium metal powder, biotechnology-based products, the development of nanotechnology-based products, the development of hydrogen fuel cells for renewable energy sources, ICT-based opportunities, and other advanced materials processes. In terms of competitiveness, we are working hard to put in place partnership initiatives whose intention, through working with industry associations, is to enhance the competitiveness of South Africa, such as the fresh produce export work we're doing through the CSIR linked to the citrus industry in South Africa, our work in aquaculture with the fishery nurseries, working in forestry materials, as well as the boat building industry. We also have a particular focus on technology capability development for manufacturing companies, which are potential suppliers for big government procurement projects, such as the energy build of government, as well as the meerkat and square kilometer array projects. Finally, with respect to strengthening industry, we are also providing funding for technology stations, which are located in universities of technology and universities across the country. And they support technology for institutions that are small and medium-sized enterprises, which cannot always afford to buy modern technology for their product development work. So these technology stations are a resource for small business to access in order to enhance their capabilities. Further details, Chairperson, can be found in the IPAP document, in the National Development Plan, in the annual reports of science and technology, and especially in the reports of TIA, the Technology Innovation Agency, our National Intellectual Property Management Office annual report, the CSIR, which is our Council for Scientific and Industrial Research, and the annual report of the South African National Space Agency. They are the most industry-focused of our entities and provide very valuable information. Thank you, Chairperson.
Thank you, Minister. Mr. Vauda?
And honorable members, Thank you, Honourable Chair. I greet all of you with Assalamu Alaikum. Honourable Chair, through you, I would like to ask the Honourable Minister that the present approach of her department, how will this relate and how is this going to support the economic development program going forward as envisaged by the Department of Economic Development? Is there a correlation between the two? Is what is being done today, especially in the universities, in the technical colleges, etc.? We do not want to arrive at a situation in a few years' time where we find that we have economic development programs in place, but because of a lack of vision, or lack of foresight, we do not have the adequate, especially the human resource capacity, but also the other capacities to support these economic development programs. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, sir. Honourable Minister.
Yes, sir, certainly, Honourable Vauda. Our interventions are directed at ensuring that insofar as is possible, because it's not an exact science, predicting the skills we need. But we do know that as South Africa, we have to do much more in terms of ensuring we have skilled knowledge workers in our society. This is why we have a very vigorous human capital development program that invests in training young people in the high skills domains of ICT, all the sciences I've made reference to, engineering, as well as technology. Because we are focused upon ensuring that we have the young people who will increasingly be absorbed into South Africa as it becomes a knowledge-based economy. This is our intention. That's why, for example, with an initiative like the Square Kilometer Array, which is not just a South African initiative, but is a global infrastructure initiative. We have sought to ensure we address both high-level skills, but also the technologists through the FET colleges who will provide the technical support to the high-skills teams working on the engineering and ICT platforms. So we are certainly, I think, very directly linked to South Africa's economic ambitions, and particularly, I think, resolute as a department to move South Africa toward becoming a knowledge-based society. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Minister. Any follow-ups? None. Honourable Minister, thank you very much. That is the end of your question time in the NCOP today. We then move on, Honourable Members, to the question posed by the Honourable E. Prince to the Minister of Agriculture, Forestry and Fisheries. Thank you, DM.
Thanks, Honourable Chairperson. The question response goes as, since 2013, the Department of Agriculture, Forests and Fisheries, DAF, has invested a total of 26,250,819.52 for students studying for various degrees within the identified scarce skills categories through external bursary scheme. In terms of the experiential training, internship and professional development program, the DAF has invested 32,247,879.99 since 2013. B, 2013 academic year, 316 students were awarded bursaries to further their studies within the identified scarce skills categories. Of these 316, 167 students were existing bursary holders. Then that was paid 15.5 million. was spent on 2013 academic year. Year 2014 academic year, 280 students were awarded bursaries to further their studies within identified skills categories. Of these 280, 133 are existing bursary holders, and then 10,800,884 rands was paid until October. That is before the end of the academic year. 2013-14 year, financial year, 285 qualified unemployed graduates were placed in the Department and Agricultural Commodity Organizations. And we paid 18,496,135.71 for placing them there. That's the money was spent for placing them. And then 2014-2015 financial year, 288 students, qualified unemployed graduates, were placed in the Department and Agricultural Commodity Organization, and we paid 13,751,744.28. That money has been paid until, that is until October, as we know that the calendar year has not been finished in academic, but that's the money that we have paid. Thanks, Honorable Chair.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. The Honorable Prince.
Thank you, Chairperson. Thank you, Honorable Deputy Minister, for the answer. Honorable Deputy Minister, can you please indicate whether the department has a plan in place to place these students after they completed their training?
Deputy Minister.
Thanks, Honorable Chair and Honorable Member. Chairperson, we have a wide field of students that we produce. There are scarce skills and the skills that would be ordinary out there. One of the scarce skills and where we would know where students are vets. We have about 3,500 vets in the Republic of South Africa. Unfortunately, only 257 are within the employ of the state. Others are private, though produced by the government, but they go private. And Honorable Chair, it might be very expensive to medically care your dog than yourself. Somebody was telling me that the dog was operated at 46,000 rands. So it's a facility that we need, and as a government, we don't mind contributing to the nation, though they don't stay within the government government space more of the time. We absorb them all at that level because it's a very scarce skill. But also engineers, agricultural engineers, we absorb them all. But there'll be those that others that will go out of crack and be independent and out there. We are, as a Department of Agriculture, creating a tracking mechanism so that even if they are not within the government employment, we know where they are, we know what they do where. So that's what we're developing at the present moment. Thanks.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. Members, anybody? The Honorable Khay.
Thank you, Honorable Chairperson. My follow-up question is supplemental questions exactly on the point that the Honorable Deputy Minister was responding to. But I just wanted to emphasize my question that making an example about Department of Health, when they give out bursaries, they are a contractual obligation that they enter into with the doctors that for a particular period they'll be working for the department. Whether there are any similar plans in the department where you issue these bursaries and then have contractual obligation with those recipients so that for a particular period they work for the department and its entities. Thank you.
Honourable TM.
Yes, Honourable Chair, with the SCA skills, we do have those contractual obligations. Immediately they expire, they get out of the system, especially the vets, the engineers, and the extension officers. Extension officers quite necessary because those that are helping the upcoming and small farmers, so it's important that they're always. But once their contractual obligations, they finish themselves, they vanish.
Members, no, the Honourable Kaula.
Thank you, Honourable Chairperson. Honourable Deputy
Minister. And Honourable Khaila, the last one is yours.
Honourable Deputy Minister, in respect of the extension officers, is the department observing any profitable outcomes in terms of food security, especially when you look at land utilization in the rural areas? For people to be able to sustain themselves in utilizing land through the extension officers. Thank you.
Honorable Deputy Minister.
Chairperson, we would have loved to maximize in that outputs where we make the inputs. But one must admit that maybe is not so at the present moment. Is it underscore that the minister has already led the discussion within the department of how do we maximize the utilization of the extension officers. Sometimes it's a way they are placed. You find that the extension officer is not in the midst of the rural farming community, but maybe lives in the city center. Which makes it difficult if there is an immediate problem for those farmers in that particular time to be called in. So these are the things we are really looking at. How do we place them in the middle of the communities that they're supposed to be serving, especially with the animal husbandry, where you find that they should be giving an immediate and urgent kind of assistance. But more so, the problem is same with them, that is they're highly absorbed by the private people. So those are the things that we are trying to work on it, but also have them exchange programs and working together even with those that they've moved to the private sector. If there are more there than the government, how do we work together? The matter has been looked at and the matter we're trying to resolve so that we maximize.
Thank you, sir. Honorable Khaila.
Inkosi sekela mphathiso olungubana ndithethe ngesixhosa yenzela uba ndiyibeke kakuhle le nto. Enye yengxaki eninazo zii-extension officers ngakumbi pha ezilalini. Naw umbuzo wokuqala, kwaba fana abana abaphuma ezikolethini abasisi ngaba bakhona abazii-extension officers na? Okwesibini, abantwana bethu abafuna usebenza ezilalini ngaba cebalini nalo obana banceda abantu because abantu abahluphekileyo bapha ezilalini. Okokugqibela, ngaba bakhona nakwabantwana abafunde ezamalwandle, sisikeski leso, ngaba bakhona ubana bekho zeziphi inzame enizenzayo ubana mabe khona kwezi kholeji? Inkosi.
Deputy Minister.
Chairperson, I don't think I got the first question very well.
The first one is there's a shortage of extension officers, especially rural. Are there any youth that, of the students that are doing extension? Or secondly, most of our youth don't want to go to the villages. What plans then do you have as a department to entice them to go to the village? Because the poverty is right at the villages. Thank you.
Thanks, Chairperson. Chairperson, if you look at the National Development Plan, calls on agriculture to produce or produce million jobs. When you speak in the department, we don't talk about 2030. We talk with next 15 years, which is much shorter rather than you say 2030. When you say 15 years, it becomes shorter and you realize that is quicker. So to produce those million jobs. But it's not only that. The instruction is that you should absorb young people within those million jobs. So it is on that score that this department is working hard to encourage and agitate youth to be the part of agriculture, starting from the school, but not only that, also becoming the part of the family of agriculture in terms of working the land and all that. Chairperson, we must say we have been quite amazed how youth has opened itself to the agricultural programs, themselves wanting to be part of farming community and all that. So yes, there is a lot of young people that are coming on board. That question then has immediate problem on the second question, that do they want to be in the rural areas? The answer is the nature of young people that they want to be on the bright cities out there in the cities. Unfortunately, you farm nothing there. For them to have that contradiction is that agriculture must work hard to make sure that they realize that they'll have to be in the rural areas. They'll have to produce food, but also there is a working towards formulating agri-villages so that young as they are, they don't lose their youth as they go to the rural areas. They must be still young. They must still do things that young people, they do there and create facilities that they will attract them in the rural areas working there. The answer there, we are trying so hard to make sure that they get attracted where farming is taking place in rural areas. The last one of the aquaculture that he speaks about, we must remember that this is a new kid on the block, the aquaculture per se. But we have gone big with Operation Pakisa that the president has been leading. And agriculture there is supposed to be big and create 167,000 jobs as in agriculture alone. The whole Operation Pakisa will have to move from 77 billion rand to 167 billion. And the big portion will have to be agriculture on the aqua, both the fresh water and the marine. Indeed, as a scarce skills, we are going to be going big to make sure that our students, Honorable Chairperson, it's got this little thing of being fashionable for young people that they are plowing and planting fish. So we hope we won't have a problem of young people getting trained there and run away. But we are working hard to make them come on board when it comes to aquaculture.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. We move on to question 225. It is posed by the Honorable CFB Smart. Honorable Deputy Minister.
The department will continue supporting farming with the fish that is currently being farming based on suitable technology, markets, and environmental conditions. Research is also underway to explore new species, but this may take time to be ready for commercial farming. The research will involve fish biology, reproduction, breeding, nutrition, genetics and production systems. Currently, there are 8 recorded freshwater species farmed in South Africa. Those would be, so Chairperson, here we have a common name that people will know, we have a scientific name and the kind of operation. Freshwater aqua species farmed in South Africa in the operational status will be a common name, that will be a rainbow trout. A scientific name is Onocultus micus. That one is farmed in a commercial scale. Then there will be a brown trout, which is known as Salmotuta, and that is commercial at a commercial scale. Then the other one will be Mozambique tilapia. Its name is Aurea chromis mosamamicus.
That is. Are they edible? That is with such difficult names, Dimi.
That is on the commercial farming. The other one will be Nile tilapia. That is Aurea chromis nilolicus on commercial farming. Then there will be African sharp tooth catfish that is called Clarias garipunus. That one is on the pilot scale. It's not yet produced on the commercial scale. And then there'll be common carp known as Cypunus capo, commercial. Then there'll be koi carp known as Cypunus capo, that is commercial. And then there'll be a maron. A maron is a freshwater crayfish, but is known as a Cherax tenunomonus. And is also on the commercial production. It's important that the members know that these are farmed on all provinces. Yes, they are farmed on the all provinces. For instance, tilapia, we have 2 places in Eastern Cape, 1 in Free State, 11 in Gauteng, 5 in KZN, 13 in Limpopo, 20 in these are operations, 20 in Mpumalanga, 3 in Northern Cape, 8 in Northwest, 2 in Western Cape. Maybe why Western Cape will have is because Western Cape is big on the marine fishing. Maybe they would not be very much encouraged to deal with the fresh water production. So there is the trout. You've got 3 in Eastern Cape, 0 in Free State, 0 Gauteng, 5 KZN. Not fish that is 0, operations that are 0. It's not fish that you can't find trout. You still find trout, others, they're natural and all, but there are no operations looking after. And then there is a catfish. Catfish. Catfish is the one that is on the pilot level. So catfish would be 1 in Eastern Cape. These operations that are pilot, 3 in Free State, 1 in GP, 0 in KZN, 3 in Limpopo, 0 in Mpumalanga, 1 Northern Cape, 1 Northwest, 0 Western Cape, 0 in Western Cape. Then crayfish will be 1 in Eastern Cape, and the rest will be 0. This crayfish will be only in Eastern Cape. For now, then there are these species. Total of all these operations of fish farming, there are 161 in the country at the present moment. That would be about this aquaculture, Chairperson.
Thank you, Honourable Deputy Minister. Honourable Smoot.
Thank you, Chairperson. Minister, has the department considered the viability of breeding kirpers and silver catfish, or called mackerel, as a cost-effective and popular food source for inland communities? If not, why not? If so, what does the research conducted to date suggest?
The Honourable Deputy Minister.
Well, Chairperson, this question has been answered, as one was giving and continuing. Starting with the first paragraph where we say the research is taking place will involve the fish biology, reproduction, breeding, nutrition, genetics, and production systems. We don't have to go for research to find out that fish has got a lot of nutrition. That's natural, that's automatic. So to give our people the balanced nutrition, we'll have to encourage them to have fish. One thing that has been discovered by research is that inland people are not big on fish eating. So that's one thing that we'll have to encourage, that they become big on the fish eating, because it's a highly balanced kind of food. Not only research we're doing, at a certain given point, there will be more fish produced, all kinds. And then our people need markets then. So even at that, we are beginning to deal with the research of how are they going to be helped when the time of them needing markets, we are going forward. But indeed, for now, it's for their nutrition. And all the fish that he speaks about of the freshwater, the research is on
running. Including mackerel. The particular species he's referring to is mackerel. Yet, with us, it's all fishmen. But the Honorable Smith says it's a mackerel, or I don't know how you pronounce it.
What are you referring?
Honorable Chairperson, I was specifically referring to the kirper and the silver catfish, which is also silver known catfish. As the mackerel.
Okay. Chairperson, yes, the cob is not part of that list, but the catfish is what I gave here to say it is on the pilot. So it's here, it's on the list, but it's on the
Yeah, what I do, to cut the dialogue, what I do seem to get from the Honorable Smith is that he is looking at a particular type of catfish, which is not necessarily the one the DM is speaking to. And I think we must agree that they have these very big and complicated to pronounce names, that perhaps we should be saying that those that are not there, maybe at a later stage the department can come back to us as to whether in part of the investigations and the research.
No, they are here. Will be.
They are all there.
There is a catfish here, unless it's got a bigger and small cat. So, but there is a catfish that is on the pilot here. Yes, on the list, the cob is not part of it. But we know we are also developing the science and the research on the cob freshwater fish. But the cat is here.
Honorable Smith, we must accept that there is a cat amongst these feet. Honorable Timunye,
I just want to respond on that you just said, Honorable Chairperson. We accept that the minister is still learning with regards on fish.
Thank you, sir. Honorable Mtimunye will be followed by Honorable Vauda, who's taking the last supplementary.
Ngikunisela othlonipheke ngithi angibuze lapha kumhlonishwa uNdosi ukuthi akhona yini amagama esinto alama fish. Ngoba uma ngeke impela abantu bakithi ngeke bazivangene kule business.
Mhlonishwa.
Members should appreciate that you are learning fast. The question of the vernacular names of this fish, the scientists are there. Most of them are seated there. But there is a TTG dealing with this fishery seated there. So maybe in their research, they'll have to work on the vernacular names, because which means each fish will have to have 11 names. Because there are 11 official languages. We are not going to get a Xhosa or Sotho, but if each fish here will have to have 11 names plus the science name, 12 each. So
the Honourable Border. The last is taken by the Honourable Abaskakhne. I'm very sorry, Honourable Issa.
Thank you, Honourable Chair. In the light of the discussions that have just been taking place regarding fish farming, we were recently in the Northern Cape, in Upington, on an oversight visit, and we saw a lot of solar energy projects and also a lot of grape farming, the vineyards, and very little else taking place. I was just wondering whether the department or any other department has intentions of establishing a fish farming along the Orange River, which meanders beautifully along across that part of the world. Thank you, Chair.
Honourable Deputy Minister.
Chairperson, in Northern Cape, as we speak, we have 5 operations. Those would be farming, 5 taking place there. Most of these would be private or also sponsored and paid by the provinces. But National Agricultural Forest and Fisheries will pay through CASP. That's its comprehensive agricultural support programs. What has been happening is that money goes to provinces and they see to it, but we are trying to work on working together to highlight some projects, to say, can't we start with this project? Being Operation Pakisa and going big on aquaculture, I think is one thing that will be encouraging working with provinces. So we will. Thanks.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. The Honourable Labaskakhne.
Thank you, Chair. Honourable Minister, I would like to know what type of support is the department offering aquaculture farmers to prevent the 12 named fish, especially the freshwater fishes, against algae and fungal infections?
Deputy Minister.
Well, the Honourable Member will be aware that governments, sometimes they work in integrated way. So the area that he speaks about will basically fall under environmental affairs, to look at the cleanliness and non-infection of waters. But together, we will make sure that we take South Africa forward by making sure that our fish are safe. We, if I'm not mistaken, they'll remind me, we have not more than 5 fish doctors at the present moment. So if we're going to be big on the aqua, so we'll have to increase very much on that scale. Work with environmental to make sure that water are fresh, but also work with the water affairs and sanitation themselves in terms of keeping water clean and making sure that foreign things that happen to water, they don't happen. But that's why I spoke about systems of fish farm systems, keep food fish balance, keep oxygen balance, and all other nutrition that fish themselves they need before those nutrition they come to us. So we'll be working together with other departments, make sure that the farming grows and we work everybody else. Thanks.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. We continue to question 226. It is posed by the Honourable Mtileni. Deputy Minister.
So go. The Amathole Forestry Company, AFC, is a level 4BE contributor which entered into a long-term forestry lease agreement with the department in 2005 for a period of 70 years, covering an area of 15,000 hectares of pine plantations. The value of lease agreement were determined in 1999 and are escalated annually using 65% of the average year-on-year production price index, in brackets PPI, as published by Statistics South Africa and reviewed every 5 years in terms of lease agreement. The average rental paid for the Amathole Forestry Company for the past 9 years has amounted on 1.8 million per annum. At present, an amount of 24 million has been collected with regards to the rental since 2005 and will be dispersed to the communities once the rightful owners have been identified through the land reform process. As you are aware, the process is facilitated by the Department of Rural Development and Land Reform with support from the department in mobilizing the affected communities. It is also worth mentioning that the company directly employs 359 people and further 1,487 through its various subsidiaries in the forestry and agricultural sectors, the majority of whom are drawn from the local communities. On the question two, the white paper in the forestry development of 1988 introduced a paradigm of sustainable forest management founded on constitutionality, on constitutional sound principles to ensure the participation and empowerment of communities affected by forestry operations. The following principles underscore the white paper. Bullet point one, the need to promote a thriving forestry sector that promotes and facilitates commercial competitiveness. Two, the need to stimulate investment in local and export wood processing industries. Three, the promotion of black economic empowerment. Four, the realization of rural development. Five, the stimulation of local job opportunities and participatory processes involving previously disadvantaged communities, taking into account their rights and aspiration. To this end, the processes of continued interactions between the company and the communities supported by the government, including the processing of land claims and formalization of informal land rights, are concrete measures to ensure the mainstreaming of community rights and interest in the sustainable forest management practices. Some of the measures include the fact that access by local communities to the plantation managed by the forestry companies is granted on the continuous basis as per Section 19 of the National Forest Act of 1998, that is Act 84 of 1998. This is granted for different activities such as the collection of firewood, mushrooms, honey harvesting, medical plants, fruit, pine tops, threshing grass, weaving grass, drawing water from rivers and streams, grazing by livestock on the old compartments. They also have access to any other forest produce for domestic use as well as access for spiritual health purposes without a license or any fee change. It is also worth noting that the land claims and land reform processes are also on course, even though none of the claims related to the AFC long-term forest release agreement have been settled as yet. Nonetheless, the department continually monitors the relationship that the company has with its surrounding communities through meetings and site visits, especially to the projects that the company is involved in for community empowerment and local economic development. To illustrate The structure of the current beneficiation arrangement, the shareholding structure, is depicted here under. The 63% is owned by Farm Investment, 8.4 is owned by workers through the Amatole Workers Trust, 12.6 is owned by Amatole Community Holding, and 16% is owned by government through SAFCOL. That would be the answer.
Thank you, sir. Just in time. Honorable Mtileni.
Deputy Minister, the companies that get these leases from the state are incredibly ridiculous prices. I have in their board senior ANC members, and some of which threaten people with guns here in this parliament. And these companies were given not just forests for ridiculous amounts, but also state machinery and houses. In this practice, not a promotion. Is this practice not a promotion of kleptocracy and lawlessness with impunity? Why is the department struggling to give many local farmers support to farm in the area of Keskama Hook? But is this only too eager to support capitalists and their ANC lackeys? Thank you.
No, thanks, Chairperson. Lackeys will try. Let me try and give the structure of forestry. It might happen that it's asking the question on the wrong person, so that we'll understand next time where to answer what question regarding forestry. Forestry is administered by five government departments. This is agriculture, ourselves.
Deputy Minister, just
is agriculture, forestry and fisheries, is department of
public works.
Is public works, is enterprise, is rural development and DTI. So forestry falls under that. Agriculture, as the department, we look at on the agricultural perspective from government. But some of these forestries are on the land that belongs to the government, and all government property falls under public works. And this land is under claim, will be given by rural. And then the business portion of it reports to SAFCOL. SAFCOL reports to government enterprise. And then DTI discusses and determines the business models. So that's how it's run. So as you deal with why agriculture is not helping, if the agriculture is not helping, it might happen that it will have to coordinate for them to be assisted, because when the forest is harvested, it must be harvested in a certain format, so that you allow the land to recoup and rehabilitate and work on the land before you replant again. Maybe if the question is not directed to the lackeys, can be directed to the government, so that we help people with the understanding, rather than, because lackeys can't help much, but the government will really help to say, this is a specific community, this is a specific problem, let's all come together and work together with the communities to make their lives better. Thanks.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. Honourable members, is there any other member who has a supplementary? None. Deputy Minister, Mr. Khayla?
Ma'am, no, Deputy Minister, one understands that there are different departments, but some of these forests are claimed, have been claimed by claimants, especially if you go in the former TBV states, Cwebe, Twesa, Langin, and all those. Now, the problem here then is that the money that is paid for rental is paid into a community trust, which is managed by members of the trust, but that money does not go to beneficiaries. Now, what one would like to know is what mechanism have you got to monitor that the money goes to the real beneficiaries? Thank you.
Honorable Deputy Minister, and that was the last supplementary.
And it's true. As the honorable member says, it has been claimed, but did not say they've been already granted. Why the money is kept with the trust is waiting for their rightful owners. Unless and until we say these are rightful owners, we're not going to give money. We allow the process of claiming until the rural development decides that these are rightful, and immediately those monies then will be paid to the rightful owners. Otherwise, we're not going to pay to claimants that might end up not winning, and we are not going to be able to collect that money to send to the rightful owners.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. Honorable members, we move on to question number 214. It is a question posed by the Honorable E. Prince to the Minister of Communications.
Thank you, Honorable Chairperson. The dispute related to a contractual obligation that was not honored by the service provider called Solar Spectrum Trading 54 that was trading as Uhuru Publishing in terms of generating revenue for selling of advertising space and distribution of the public sector magazine. The agreement was entered between the former Department of Government Communications and Information Systems and stipulated that the service provider will pay GCIS a share of the revenue generated through the selling of advertising space in the magazine. This was a three-year contract that started on 8 April 2011 and it has since expired on the 7th of April 2014. At the end of the 2013-2014 financial year, three payments to the total value of 204,725 rand was received from the service provider out of the 6.7 million remaining with an adjusting outstanding amount of 6.5 million. The department has a formal debt collection policy in place and is currently pursuing a recovery plan to collect the revenue as it was due to the former GCIS in terms of the contractual agreement. Nevertheless, honorable members will also ensure that there is remedial action for those officials who could be found having failed to exercise due diligence in contract management. I thank you.
Thank you, Minister. The Honorable Prince.
Thank you, Honorable Minister, for the question. Honorable Minister, did GCIS...
Honorable Prince, please get closer to the mic.
Thank you.
Again.
Honorable, I'm very smooth. Honorable Minister, did GCIS have a signed contract with the service provider? And has the minister put in place measures to strengthen your department's internal controls, especially on procurement processes, so as to ensure that a similar incident does not happen in future? Thank you.
Honorable Minister.
Thank you, Honorable Member. Yes, there was a three-year contract that was signed with the supplier on the 7th of April, 2011, which had a termination clause which stipulated that in case of changes in government procedures or unsatisfactory services, the department was entitled to terminate the contract. Like I've indicated earlier, the department has a debt recovery strategy which is being implemented. And then, like I indicated also, that was a 3-year contract and it was only discovered at the end, at the expiry of the contract. Then we are busy looking at the matter together with National Treasury and the AG to say that should there be officials who were responsible for not implementing the contract as agreed, then there will be remedial action. More so that there is policies in place that has to be implemented. I thank you.
Minister, honorable members, any other supplementary? The honorable Mtileni.
I'm posing my question to know that, you know, most of the time, if there are those who are found to be, you know, on the wrong side of the law in terms of, having been involved in some activities, some fraudulent activities, you find that when, some are ANC members, and you find that when they happen to have been involved, instead of, you know, having them to face the might of the law, they just, shrub them from one department to another. I just want to know if, is this not going to happen? Because this is the kind of sickness that we are facing in this government.
Thank you, Honorable Mtileni. Honorable Mtileni, the minister must respond to this if she is dealing with the employees of her department and not the employees of Lituli House. Because if they are employees of the ANC, then she's not competent to answer. If she is going to answer, it will be in relation with the employees who the member says he extrapolates from your previous response that people who are doing wrong are not being followed up. Honorable Minister.
Thank you, Honorable Chair. You know the public service has got the disciplinary code and procedures that has to be followed. Like I've indicated earlier, should we find out that during the investigation process, there were officials who failed to exercise due diligence in doing the contract management, we'll follow that disciplinary code and procedures for the public servant. And it doesn't see any color. It just had to be complied with. This is the disciplinary code and procedures for public servants.
Thank you, Minister. The Honorable Kaula.
Thank you, Honorable Chairperson. Honorable Minister, thank you very much. I don't know if I heard the Honorable Minister well in that the contract ran for 3 years. And at the end, right towards the end of the contractual period, then this irregularity was sort of detected. Don't you find that strange, Minister, that a contract will run for 3 years and at the exit point, I know it was not during your time, but you know you have inherited it. You inherit everything, good or bad. Don't you find that strange that it runs for 3 years and when it is towards exit, something wrong is detected?
Honorable Minister.
Thank you, Honorable Chair. I think the follow-up question by Honorable Prince was trying to address what you have just raised now to say, and we have responded to that question to say, together with National Treasury and AG, we are looking at that contract, and then should we find that there were those officials that didn't exercise due diligence in contract management, then we'll apply the disciplinary code and the procedures for public servants.
Thank you, honorable members. That question is gone. There is no fourth follow-up. We move on to question 215. Honorable Prince.
I respectfully request that question 215 on the question paper be withdrawn. Due to a typing error in the question that relates to the amount of 2.8 million, which is not the correct amount. I will resubmit the question.
Thank you, ma'am. Honorable members, question 215 has been withdrawn. The member says she will resubmit. We then move on to question 232, Honourable Minister. It is a question posed by the Honourable Vauda.
Thank you, Honourable Chairperson and Honourable Member, for asking the question. The Department believes in the independence of the media and editorial independence. Government, like all other public and private sector entities, commissions programs and documentaries on televisions and other media platforms in order to inform the general public on its programs of action and implementation. In doing so, government always comply fully with the editorial decisions of the media institution. It's also our considered view that government can commission its work to any media house, and it also pays for advertising space in terms of the rates applicable to all public and private entities. Thank you, Honorable Chair.
Thank you, ma'am. Honorable Vauda.
Thank you, Honorable Chair. We would like to determine from the Honorable Minister, how did this actually come about? Was it initiated by the department, or was this initiated by ENCA? What discussions transpired during the process? And if the minister could give us an idea as to what the details of these discussions were, especially with regard to the content of the programs, and that type of issue. Thank you.
Honourable Minister.
Thank you, Honourable Chair. We haven't received a formal complaint save for the media reports that we've seen. But we are of the view that, indeed, if ETV feels that they have been strong-armed to bend their editorial discretion, then they must raise the matter formally with ICASA and provide evidence. We believe that ICASA will then be able to act accordingly. I thank you, Honorable Chair.
Thank you, Minister. The Honorable Smith.
Thank you, Honorable Chairperson. Given the Minister's answer in principle that it is not ethical for government to interfere with the independence of broadcasting houses, would the Minister please explain what measures she has in place to ensure that the independence of the SABC, and in particular, whether it is then appropriate for such a politically well-connected person such as Ellen Chabalala to serve as the chairperson of the SABC?
Honourable Smith, the question is whether, in the light of the alleged funding of the ETV by the Department of Economic, the question has nothing to do with the SABC or its board. And I do understand that the Honourable Member was taking a chance. Minister, you are at liberty to make your choice whether to answer this. But it is a completely different question. It's not a supplementary.
I'll agree with you, Honorable Chairperson, but I think I need to emphasize this, to say that the public broadcaster have got a mandate to inform and educate the nation. As government, we respect the constitutional right as enshrined in the Constitution of freedom of speech, and that includes the freedom of media. Then we won't interfere in the affairs of any broadcaster.
Thank you, Honourable Minister. Is there any other member? No more supplementaries. That takes care of question 232, Honourable Members. Honourable Members, we have been informed that both the Minister and the Deputy Minister of Environmental Affairs have tendered in their apologies, and therefore that they have not made any arrangement with any other minister, thereby leaving only the option that their questions be for written response. We will follow up as to the reasons why both minister and deputy ministers would go and not make adequate arrangements. We have spoken about this in the House, so we'll follow up on this. We move on, honorable members, to question number 218, and it is a question posed by the honorable Masango to honorable...
Sorry, Chair. This was a scheduled session. Now, if a minister or deputy minister doesn't attend and they don't make any other alternative arrangements, are we going to make sure that those ministers get back to this House at the later stage to answer the questions that they were supposed to answer?
Thank you, sir. We will follow the processes which we had. The usual process is if both minister or deputy minister are unable to make it, they make arrangement with their colleagues in cabinet. And if they are unable, they do submit to us. The first option they have, of course, is for the questions to be converted to written response. But that at any stage, we will, and we have been following up on the ministers, and that is what I have told the House. We will follow up and find out what made the minister and the deputy minister not come. And I think this is as far as we can take it today, Honorable Lund. We will follow up. We will report back to the House. The Honorable Masango asked the Minister of Minerals. The Honorable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson, and thanks to the member for the question. It is actually very difficult to determine the number of illegal miners, since illegal mining involves criminal activities with the location and modus operandi constantly changing as government and other relevant stakeholders are implementing measures to eradicate illicit operations. But just to give a perspective in terms of the quantum, according to a 2007 study, it was estimated that illegal activities result in a loss of about 10% of the total gold produced by the sector annually, which was then valued at about 5.6 billion rands of gold stolen and smuggled out of the country. Reports indicate that the recent escalation in illegal mining is also as a result of a local and global crime syndicates taking advantage of increasing number of desperate people, mainly from neighboring countries, willing to risk their lives by being involved in these activities. These syndicates arrange weapons and hitmen to kill rival gangs. As a result, several deaths have been reported and law enforcement agencies and government officials' lives have been put at risk. In addition, the syndicates organize illegal miners to force their way into old underground workings, which have been sealed by government and the mines, by digging around concrete seals or by blasting them away with stolen explosives. It is against that background that the Department of Mineral Resources established illegal mining stakeholder forums in Mpumalanga, Free State, Gauteng, and Northern Cape provinces for the purpose of continuously identifying and sealing open shafts and other openings, as well as conducting operations to combat illegal mining. The Illegal Mining Stakeholders Forum meet once a month and comprise, amongst others, the Department of Mineral Resources, National Prosecuting Authority, South African Police Services, Council for Geosciences, Mine Health and Safety Council, municipalities, mining companies, and organized labor. Also, the Justice Crime Prevention and Security Cluster, that is the Cabinet Committee, directed that relevant departments be brought to board, be actually brought on board. This led to the establishment of the Multi-Agency National Coordinated Strategic Management Team. This team is currently implementing a strategy to address problems associated with illegal mining. If I may continue, the Chairperson, these are the following are some of the key achievements since the establishment of this team, the NCSMT, and the stakeholder forum. One, the DMR and the Council for Geoscience have successfully closed a number of open shafts or open holes. also identified areas with gold-bearing material where were mined successfully in areas which experienced illegal mining activity. Access control at some mines has improved, amongst others, the introduction of biometric systems. There is now frequent vetting of security personnel at the mines. Law enforcement agencies have conducted successful disruptions of these operations, raids, and arrests. A mine manager was arrested after he was allegedly found in possession of 1.3 kilograms of gold, believed to have been 80% pure and worth about half a million rands. 20 employees were arrested at one of the major gold mines for gold theft. It is believed that the above employees are part of a syndicate. SAPS recently arrested Diamond Syndicate members who were mainly operating in the Northern Cape. 18 police officials were arrested in the Free State for being involved in illegal mining activities. A court order granted also has also been granted for the Asset Forfeiture Unit Authority to confiscate 6.2 million rands worth of assets held by members of an unwrought gold syndicate. As a way forward, the department will continue collaborating with the relevant law enforcement agencies and social partners to ensure that there is a national strategy to coordinate and combat illegal mining. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. The Honorable Smith is Ms. Masango for today.
Yes, on behalf of
Honorable Smith.
Thank you, Honorable Chairperson. I would like to know from the Minister which other stakeholders are actively involved in eradicating the illegal mining activities.
Honorable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. The stakeholders that I've listed here are the stakeholders, but they are also, I can just repeat them if the member did not get them properly, but they include the DMR, the NPA, SAPS, Council for Geoscience, MANT, the Health and Safety Council, the municipalities, different various companies where this is taking place, and the organized labor. And over and above that, I've included that we've got a multi-agency national coordinated strategic management team that involves also at some stages where we involve the Department of Defense where it's necessary. So these are the stakeholders that I've mentioned, and we're also looking into a strategy that can deal with this matter very decisively. As I indicate to you, member, this matter is very syndicated with very sophisticated syndicates both in South Africa and abroad. So at this platform, we cannot disclose all the details of how we are dealing with this because this information is in the public domain. Thank you very much.
The Honorable Kaula, the Honorable Khai, the Honorable Mithileni, that order.
Yeah, it was a thanks, Honorable Deputy Minister. Honorable Deputy Minister, in respect of illegal stroke improper sand mining, what would be the proper steps that have to be taken? I have got a community. The minister next to you knows the area in along the Mzumbe River, where the community of the area where we come from, the three of us here, they are really being harassed by those who claim to be having licenses to mine sand. The matter has been reported to the police. No steps have been taken. Now they are looking for other steps to say it has to be corrected. So what would be those steps? Because it has been reported, no steps taken. We now need the intervention of one or two of your department will be those areas of conduit where we have to look into. And if the Honorable Deputy Minister would like to come to the area to see for himself what's happening, the community is open to that. Thank you.
Deputy Minister.
Thank you, Chairperson. I think we can liaise with the member. They can send us the details and we'll certainly follow up. Because in all provinces, we do have the presence of officers of the DMR. So if we get it as soon as possible, we can dispatch the officials to take care of that matter and report back to us, and we can attend to that matter. Thank you very much.
Thank you, DM. The broader question was, what is the department doing when communities feel they are being undermined and being harassed?
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Because it's a broad question, we don't deal with the same communities. There are other matters. We deal with matters as and when they arrive. And in this instance, because we don't have all the details, because you are specific about that community, then it's important that we get the detail before we just apply a blanket approach.
Honorable Kaula, the Deputy Minister is undertaking to send a fact-finding team, which will then respond to the communities. Honorable Khai.
Thank you, Honorable Chairperson. We would like to commend the department for the number of arrests that have taken place. But my question is on the conviction rate, if the Deputy Minister can respond on that.
Deputy Minister?
Initially, in the initial stages of arresting these people, the charges were not very firm. So the conviction rate was very low. Since we have been engaged with the police on all these matters and having people in possession of this, of the material and the gold itself, the conviction rate has increased. At this stage, because there are still ongoing cases, I'm unable to give the statistics. Thank you very much.
The Honourable Mtileni.
I stand to ask, of the 34 miners killed in Marikana, how many were legal and how many were illegal? How many were legal and how many were illegal?
Honorable Mtileni, please repeat your question.
I'm saying of the 34 miners killed in Marikana, how many were legal and how many were illegal?
Thank you, sir. I thought I did not understand you. Honorable Deputy Minister, do you want to respond to that question? The question is unrelated to the illegal mining, which is the principal question posed to you.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. We would advise the members to be patient and wait for the processes that are taking place to be concluded. There is a forum call mission taking place, and we all are waiting for that report. So I'll advise the member to be patient and not just rush to issues that are not concluded. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Honorable members, that takes care of question number 218. We move on to question number 234, which was posed by the Honorable Mateis. Honorable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. The department is aware of allegations about transfer pricing. Accordingly, engagements have been taking place and continue to take place with other relevant and competent institutions such as National Treasury. And as stated earlier, there are a number of allegations that are made about this matter. However, those allegations that have been brought to our attention do not contain comprehensive quantification of the extent of this phenomenon. Thank you very much.
The Honorable Vauda is for today, the Honorable Mateis. Honorable Vauda.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Honorable Chair.
You are protected, Honorable Vauda.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you. I have listened with some concern, Honourable Minister, and also with great sadness, the discussion a few minutes ago on so-called illegal mining, and not for one moment do I wish to condone crime, but I think we need to have empathy for the situation in this country, Honourable Minister.
Honourable Vauder, it is within your 2 minutes.
Yes, ma'am.
But please come back to the question and the follow-up
so right
as posed by the Honourable Mateis. You are rising on that
so
question.
I'm doing so right now, Honourable Chair. I'm doing so right now. The AIDC's report titled The Bermuda Connection, Profit Shifting and Unaffordability at Lonmin, found that the 2.3 billion rand Lonmin transferred to Bermuda subsidiaries could have paid up 72% of the 12,500 rand a month the rock drillers were demanding in Marikana. The report further found that between 2008 and 2012, $162 million was paid in commissions to Western Metal Sales. What we would like to know, Honourable Minister, is does the department believe that the demand by mine workers of a minimum 12,500 salary is reasonable, and does the government have plans to realise this? And also, Honourable Minister, if the findings of the AIDC are found to be correct, what will the government do at one, and what kind of penalties will be instituted? Thank you, Honourable Chair.
Honourable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. When it comes to decent wages for mine workers, we all subscribe to that. But at this stage, because the question of mine workers in that situation was subjected to collective bargaining, we respect the outcome of those collective bargaining processes. Now, to this report, and I must also say, because at some stage we got involved as the DMR to try and facilitate a conclusion of those negotiations. Some of these reports were put on the table for discussions, and all parties looked at them and agreed at the, on the outcome of the negotiation. Now, we can also not prejudge what would be done when National Treasury or any other institution of government finds any fault with these companies. So I would also appeal that as the process is undertaken and we're looking into cases as they come to us, we wait for the right remedies from the relevant institutions. At this stage, we cannot preempt or prejudge what would be the outcome. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Deputy Minister. Any other supplementary? The Honourable Lewis-Kahni.
Thank you, Chair. Honourable Minister, according to the report published by the advocacy group Global Financial Integrity, it is estimated that South Africa has lost around about 1 trillion rand through illicit outflows of capital from 2002 to 2011 due to transfer pricing and base erosion. How will the Organization for Economic Operation and Development, that organization's recommendations emanating from their base erosion and profit shifting projects affect the department's policies?
Thank you, Deputy Minister.
As we have indicated, Chairperson, there are a lot of allegations in the public domain that come to this. But those cases that are given to Treasury or to the Department for investigation, we do that. And so far, we have not come to any conclusion that says that all these issues are correct or they can be followed up properly. So we are working together with Treasury and the institutions that report to Treasury to investigate all allegations that are coming to us. Thank you very much.
Thank you. That was the end of question 234. Thank you very much, Deputy Minister. We move on to question 222. It is posed by Honorable C. Lewis-Kahni to the Minister of Public Enterprises. Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. I would like to thank Member Lewis-Kahni for her question. Work on international benchmarks and stakeholder consultation on this multifaceted policy to consolidate, where possible, and coordinate where necessary, all government activities that have a bearing on air transportation is ongoing. There are a number of key decisions that are required to achieve a whole of state aviation policy framework. These include, amongst others, the following: visa controls, express international passenger processing, rationalization of antitrust immunity rules, fiscal transfer mechanisms on non-profitable strategic routes, alignment of ACSA and ATNS objectives with that of airlines, endorsement of Fly South Africa carriers for government-funded travels, and awarding of air travel rights through a structured and coordinated process. A successful policy will therefore require cooperation between various government departments and will only be possible once all its aspects are fully addressed. Given this approach, it is not possible at this stage to be certain of the effective date of implementation of the policy. It is our view as the Department of Public Enterprises that a whole of state aviation policy by its nature will benefit all locally registered public and privately owned carriers by creating an enabling and sustainable air transportation environment which is supported by all spheres of government. The long-term turnaround strategy of South African Airways strongly advocates for this policy. I thank you.
The Honorable Labuskagne.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you, Deputy Minister. You answered part of that on the effect of the SA Airways. I would like to know, what do you think would be the effect of this policy when it's being implemented on the South African Airways and its subsidiaries?
The Honourable Deputy Minister.
We think that that is why the long-term turnaround strategy supports, advocates for this policy. It will be good for the airline and its subsidiaries, because, for instance, if you look at visa processing, it's one of the impediments that affects tourists who wants to come to South Africa. So if, for instance, the Department of Home Affairs can speed up the processing of transit visas, it will really assist and so that we can also capture the lost market.
Thank you, DM. The Honorable Smith, the Honorable Mikilakos, the Honorable Mtileni, those take care of the supplementaries. Smith?
Thank you, Honorable Chairperson. Is the department aware of the fact that there are high levels of frustration regarding the undescribable effects of the whole of state aviation policy framework on the success rate of A, implementing the programs, and B, achieving the strategic objective of South African Airways? With SAA's troubled financial state, and given that SAA continues to incur a 31% average operating profit margin loss on 5 international routes that are not profitable, would it not be advisable to place a moratorium on the policy to allow South African Airways to become a financially profitable first?
Honourable Deputy Minister.
Part of the problem is that we do not have a whole of state policy.
Honourable Deputy Minister, you are very soft.
Okay. I'm saying, Chairperson, part of the problem is that we do not have the whole of state aviation policy. And some of these routes that are loss making are routes that are very strategic for the country. But it is important that there is a thorough consultation between the Department of Tourism, the Department of Transport, DPE, and other departments around this issue. So it will be difficult just to preempt based on what you're saying.
Thank you, sir. The Honorable Mikilakos has opted out. Honorable Mtileni.
Thanks. Mine is very simple. Of late, we have been reading about the infighting in the SAA of top executive members. I just want to know if government is in any way trying to get that resolved, because in the end, it could be the main cause to what has just been mentioned by Honorable Smith, that of finding the SAA being jacked year in and year out when it comes to their budget, because they get their budget finished before the end of the term. So is that infighting not causing such kind of problems?
Honorable
Deputy Minister. New question, but related to what he has to answer. Thank you.
Honorable Order members, Honorable Deputy Minister, I am not sure I understood the questions.
I think it will be important to stick to the rule of relevance. I'm not sure about the relevance of the question to the whole of state aviation policy.
Honorable Deputy Minister, you are very soft. If I can't hear you, I am wondering if anybody can hear you.
Okay, thank you. I must speak into the mic.
Yes, sir.
Yes. I'm saying it will be important to stick to the rule of relevance. I'm not sure about the relevance of that question to the whole of state aviation policy.
Honorable Mtileni.
The question is very relevant because you see...
Honorable Mtileni, I have not given you the... Please put. I have not given you the right to speak. Order members. The reason I said I did not understand your questions was that I was trying to find the tie between the fights of people in the board and the need to stabilize policy and the question as posed by the Honorable Smith, who was speaking to policy and viability and looking at different options of making the airline sustain itself. And that is why I said I didn't get you. The Deputy Minister, I think we must advise our Honorable Member to write a question, to put your views as a question which can be responded to in future. Honorable members, that then takes care of the question which was posed by the Honorable Labuskagne, and we move on to question 230. It is a question posed by the Honorable TJ Mukwili to the Minister of Public Enterprise, Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. I would like to thank the member for her question. The working relationship between the Department of Public Enterprises and other departments is based on the principles of cooperative government and intergovernmental relations as espoused in Section 40 and Section 41 of the Constitution. It is intended to contribute towards efficient use of resources by the state, thus it requires shareholder ministers to coordinate actions on matters of common interest with relevant state organs and other spheres of government to enhance synergy between government shareholding, treasury controls, sector policies, and the implementation of the integrated infrastructure planning to promote an effective, transparent, and accountable government. In certain instances, consultations relating to the state-owned companies' businesses have specific timelines within which to respond. For an example, a PFMA Section 54 application requires a response in 30 days from the date of final submission from the SOC board. The department and the National Treasury work closely together to finalize these applications. Where an application is complex and requires more discussion and consultation, mechanisms are in place to extend the timeline. The state-owned companies are compelled to report in compliance with the PFMA on all reportable matters. These reports are submitted simultaneously to the department and the National Treasury. However, exceptions are made to engage with cabinet colleagues and other departments more frequently when necessary to deal with more complex situations. We also engage through interministerial bilateral meetings to ensure good governance of the state-owned companies, discuss financial matters as well as the impact of policy on the mandate of the state-owned companies. The ultimate common objective is to balance the interests of the state with those of the state-owned companies, where at all times the sovereign is protected. In addition to the PFMA reporting requirements alluded to, the department has developed the strategic intent statement, which must be cascaded into the shareholder compact and the corporate plan. The statement is the pinnacle of the shareholder oversight framework, which is primarily designed to hold boards and management to account for financial, operational, and developmental performance indicators in the achievement of the mandate of the state-owned companies. The framework is also supported by the guidelines such as the Competitive Supplier Development Program and the Remuneration Standard, which, amongst other things, ensure alignment between remuneration levels and the performance scorecard of executives to the shareholder compact.
Thank you very much, Honorable Member. Honorable Vada, are you standing in for Honorable Mateis? No, Mukwele.
Mukwele. Thank you very much indeed, Honorable Deputy Chair. Please allow me a moment. I've noticed that the Honorable Deputy Minister is wearing a very beautiful suit. a touch of a red tie will really look, he'll look very dashing indeed. Honourable Deputy Chair, the question we would like to ask is, wouldn't it make more financial sense for the entities under your department to be integrated into their respective departments as follows: Transnet, SAA and SA Express into the Transport Department, Eskom into the Energy Department, Broadband Franco into Communications, Denel into Defence, etc. Are these entities run for profits or for the greater good of our country? If not, what are some of the financial decisions to support such a claim? Thank you, Honourable Deputy.
Honourable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. What is important to appreciate is that there is a need to clarify or to distinguish the roles of government as the owner, as a policymaker, as a regulator, and the implementer. In the main, the need for separation is to facilitate the principle of competitive neutrality. There is also a need to codify and harmonize shareholder management practices across government. I see no reason why we should agree with the Honorable Member, because that will go against the need to codify these management practices across government.
Thank you very much. Is there any other supplementary question? Honorable Makalakis.
Thank you, Honorable Deputy Chairperson. Honorable Minister, the recent collapse of a silo at the Mayuba Power Station in Mpumalanga has highlighted the need for cooperation between the department, between your department rather, and other departments. How will your department and the Department of Energy then work together to ensure that the country's electricity generating infrastructure is maintained to avoid further costly and catastrophic interruptions through load shedding to the country's economy?
Honourable Deputy Minister.
As we speak, Honourable Deputy Chairperson, there is an IMC that deals with that. Even in the morning, we were in the PICC with also the Deputy Minister of Energy, dealing also with the issue, dealing with the issues relating to Kusile and Midupi. So there is cooperation and integrated planning and monitoring of the infrastructure build program, even through the ICC, which is the Presidential Infrastructure Coordinating Commission.
Thank you very much, Honourable Members. Any other supplementary question? None.
Thank you very much, Chair. Do I understand correctly, Deputy Minister, that you're actually saying that between the Department of Public Enterprises and the Department of Energy, that the only organization responsible for looking at maintenance and ensuring that is that structure that you mentioned now, and that the department doesn't take any responsibility for that?
Honourable Labaskakhne, I don't want to interpret your question. Can you just please summarise your question?
I would like the Deputy Minister to give an answer. He said that this integrated, I didn't catch the whole AGR, that AGR is responsible for ensuring the maintenance of the infrastructure between those departments. So, does the department itself, the Department of Public Enterprises, has no responsibility for that? And if not, why not? And what is the responsibility or the link then between the IGR and the Department of Public Enterprises?
Honourable Deputy Minister, I don't know whether if you have the appetite to respond to that question.
I think it will be important for infrastructure development program to succeed. We need an integrated approach. For an example, you would need the Department of Water, you would need the Department of Energy, you would need a lot of other departments to work with. Even for the infrastructure maintenance, we have ESCOM that is responsible for the maintenance, but it also reports both to the Department of Public Enterprises and even to the PICC, which was established by the President to ensure that bottlenecks are unblocked so that we can fast-track the infrastructure development program, and we can also ensure that there are no overrun costs. If they are, we try and minimize them. That is why we have the PICC. There is no abrogation of responsibility.
Thank you very much. I take it that was the last question. We then now proceed. Oh, Honorable Van Lingen.
Thank you, Chairperson. As far as I'm concerned, the PICC is on infrastructure development and strategic projects. I thought Honorable Labuschagne's question was specifically related to the maintenance to ensure that we don't have further blackouts in this country because there is a lack of maintenance by certain departments for which the Minister and the Department of Energy are responsible. So it is not infrastructure development, but a maintenance issue. And in this particular case, it is an entity for which the Minister is responsible.
May I just caution ourselves, Honourable Member? I don't want to go back to the rule of relevance, because if you look at the nature of the question, it's about cooperation. And the minister tried to go beyond, but I'll allow him an opportunity if he wants to respond to the issue related to maintenance and abdication of responsibility so far as maintenance is concerned. If you have the appetite, that's why I asked the question, whether you have the appetite to answer.
If you build without maintenance, you are built to fail. That is why there's that integration. Okay. I'm saying, Deputy Chairperson, if you build without incorporating maintenance, you are building to fail. That is why there is this interrelationship between maintenance and the infrastructure build program. But the PICC, working with the departments, is trying to coordinate that, one, the infrastructure build program is on time and there is proper maintenance.
Okay. In simple terms, for purposes of good governance, there is cooperation amongst departments and the entities that falls under the department. All right. Thank you very much. Then we proceed to the next question. The next question is by question number 261 by Honorable Khaila. To the Minister of Rural Development and Land Reform. Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Our response is that the Department of Rural Development and Land Reform does not issue certificates of occupation. I suspect that the member wanted to speak about something else, which I can continue to educate him. What we are doing, we are issuing title deeds for ownership to communities that their claims have been settled. To the said person that he has indicated, Mr. Phakamile Mamba, launch a land claim on behalf of the Zimbane community. He does not have a claim independent of the community claim. In the interest of efficient processing of claims, the efficient utilization of the resources of the Commission on Restitution and Land Right, and the fact that the circumstances and time of dispositions of the Zimbane and Kwalindile community are similar, the Commission processes the two claims simultaneously, followed the decision of the Constitutional Court that if a claim are valid, the claim must be restored to communities. The Commission has been facilitating discussions to the settlement of the claim between the two communities, the King Sabata Talinjebo Municipality and the Eastern Cape Provincial Department of Local Government and Traditional Affairs, a memorandum of agreement recording the terms of settlement is currently being discussed by the parties. Thank you very much, Chairperson.
Thank you very much, Deputy Minister. Honorable Khaila, do you have a supplementary question?
Thank you. Thank you, DM, for educating me. Thank you very much. Honorable Vavda, it seems you like to appreciate men. It's about the third time you're appreciating men. Have you seen the beautiful red colored dress of the chief whip? Yeah. Why don't you appreciate the ladies? Thank you. Now,
I don't know, Honorable Khaila, what are you insinuating?
Honorable Deputy Chairperson, there's a misspelling. Mamba was supposed to be ivory timber. There's also a mamba in ivory timber. The mamba of Zimbabwe has passed away some time back. So there's a misspelling. Sorry about that, DM. DM, the Honorable Deputy Minister of Rural Development, Honorable Tulas Ngesi, went to visit these communities about 6-7 years back. And there were promises then made that these claims would be finalized. Whether if you call it certificates, we'd add that, but the bottom line here is the finalization of these claims. Now, what happens then now currently on some of those lands, for instance, in Highbury, the structures have totally collapsed. Squatters have taken over that land. So what are these beneficiaries going to get? It's more than 12 years that these claims have been there. The question is, when are these claims being finalized, Chairperson? Secondly, Chairperson, there's a lands claim commissioner who does not even meet with the Ivory people, in terms of Ivory. But the real question here is, when are they being finalized? So that, and if they are then finalized by then, is the government going to assist them to rebuild the structures that have collapsed? And what about these people that have taken their land? What is the government doing about that, the department doing about that? Thank you.
Okay. Honorable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Now the question has just become a little bit clearer. Well, not only that community that has been visited by the former deputy ministers, but as I said, the claimants were two groups coming from different areas, which means that, and the disposition is the same and the area is the same. As a department, we need to consolidate the two people, two groups of claimant, and restitute them as one. And one group went to court, preventing the other not to have their land right. So we agreed with the court to say, definitely, if everybody is valid, we will validate all of them, which means the title deeds that will be issued there, it will be issued for all of them, not for one group. So that is the discussion that is underway with the municipality locally and with the provincial government, because there's a conflict there. I'm not sure about Mr. Mamba that has passed on, but Mr. Mamba claimed on behalf of another community. It is still on the record, and he must rest in peace. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I take it that there's no any other supplementary question. All right, we then proceed to the next question by Honorable Masango. Honorable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Our response to the question of the Honorable Member is that the enrollment statistics of the National Rural Youth Service Corps initiative per provinces are as follows. In the Eastern Cape, we've got 2,540. Free State, 763. Gauteng, 2,035. KwaZulu-Natal, 1,545. Limpopo, 2,822. Mpumalanga, 857. Northwest, 1,411. Northern Cape, 1,045. Western Cape, 1,558. The total is 14,576 up to so far. Thank you very much, Chairperson.
Honorable Deputy Minister, Honorable Masango is not in here. You can't say that you are standing here. I will allow you to make supplementary question. Don't have any formal communication indicating that who's standing in for. But you may proceed because the minister has already answered.
Thank you, Deputy Chair. According to me, there is a communication that actually confirms that I'm standing in for.
I allowed you to proceed.
Okay, thank you. Has the minister approached the Department of Small Business businesses to devise an integrated strategy to ensure that the NARISEC alumni have the opportunities to find employment and or start their own small businesses after their tenure in the program?
Honourable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Yes, we are in partnership with all relevant departments here. One example is that some of the youth are trained in the FET and we've got a partnership with the Department of Higher Education. Definitely the Small Business Department, as a department that started this financial year, we have been communicating with the former department in terms of cooperative development and training and small business formation. We are also in discussion with them in terms of establishing a mega cooperative for the NARISEC group in the built industry. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Is there any other supplementary question? In the absence of any, then we shall proceed to the next question by Honorable Smith, Honorable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Our response to the Honourable Member's question is that the Department of Rural Development and Land Reform does not have records of the land claim called Matebeleng Village in the Mogalakwena local municipality. However, the inquiry is welcome to furnish the Commission on Restitution and Land Rights with further information regarding this claim. As it stands now, we don't have such a claim. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Honorable Smith.
Honorable Deputy Chairperson, it's not by name, it is where the village is, which is Vienen. But in any way, as the Mogalakwena local municipality could not provide basic services to the community of Matebeleng, who has been living at Matebeleng Village since 1979 for the 16 years due to the protracted land claim lodged in 1998. Does the minister think that it is fair to this community to disadvantage the community further by not addressing the uncertainties of its future?
Deputy Minister, I don't know if you have got interest to respond to that.
Well, my interest is that they might think that they've launched the claim. It is not registered. And that's the response I've given. And I'm still appealing to the members that they must advise the community to go and launch the claim to our offices as much as the launchment has been opened. Thank you very much.
Any other follow-up question? Okay, Honorable Khai.
Thank you, Honorable Deputy Chairperson. I just wanted to find out if the department has an information system that indicates the status of land claim possible by municipalities. Thank you.
Honorable Deputy Minister.
Yes, we have the information system that indicates the claim that has been launched in every piece of land in the country, even in different municipalities. That's why this one, it does not reflect anyway. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I take it that there's no any other follow-up question. We then proceed to the next question by Honorable Bauda to the Minister, Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Our response is that not all the outstanding land claims have been researched to determine the exact extent of the properties and right under the claim, and as such, a definitive amount that is required cannot be provided. However, the National Treasurer did an expenditure and performance review of the restitution program based on the number of outstanding claims as at the 31st of March 2013. Estimating the cost of settlement of those claims based on the same percentage of land restoration claim and claim settled through financial compensation. At the stage, it was estimated by the National Treasurer that an amount of 16.9 billion will be required to settle those claims. The subsection question is that the restitution program is funded through the normal budget of government, and as such, the budget is systematically and programmatically allocated over the medium-term expenditure framework. As such, the duration will be determined by the resources that are available at a given time through this process, as well as the complexity and scope of the claim. The department has previously, through budget policy speech, indicated that the target of 30% by 2014 will not be met, and has alluded to the challenge and intervention in this regard. The National Development Plan sets a new trajectory to land reform in terms of Vision 2030. The department's land acquisition strategy, which focuses on de-racializing the rural economy, creating a new class of black commercial farmers, and production discipline in order to ensure food security for all is aligned to the Vision 2030. The assumption that the land reform process is legitimizing apartheid disposition is misplaced. The department has, on numerous occasions, set out its plan thus far and going forward in terms of reversing the legacy of the 1913 Native Land Act and related legislation that resulted in land disposition. All the department's efforts thus far have been and are still aimed at reversing the effect that colonialism and apartheid has on the people of South Africa. In this instance, black people and African in particular, the land reform program remains committed to achieving the objectives of the agrarian transformation strategy and the principles set out in the Green Paper on Land Reform. Thank you, Chairperson.
Thank you very much. Honorable Vare.
Thank you, Honorable Chair. I am obliged then to begin by appreciating the beautiful red dress of the Honorable Cathy Dlamini. and the Honorable Gaylor will look a lot better. He needs a red tie, eh? Thank you, Honourable Deputy Chair, Honourable Deputy Minister. The government, and this is a very serious issue, so let's get serious, guys. The government has been playing, dice, really, with land reform and the emotions of dispossessed people in South Africa for far too long. The department's land reform strategy seems to be now focusing more on production rather than redressing the very serious issues of the history in this country. We challenge the department, to acknowledge that the present legislation, the present systems are not going to deliver on this very serious issue. And we challenge the department. I am within my 2 minutes, Chair. Am I protected, Chair? I'm within the 2 minutes.
Order, please.
We challenge the department to make the relevant fundamental policy changes in order to be able to implement land reform in this country that will redress a very, very serious issue in this country. And the only way going forward is to make these relevant changes. We challenge the department to do this, and we ask, when is the department going to undertake these changes? Thank you, Chair.
Honourable Minister, it's your prerogative to respond or to engage.
Well, Chairperson, I never received that challenge, but I'm still waiting for that challenge because they are speaking in different tongues as their organization. We have presented a policy proposal on the table. They are saying it is perpetuating the eviction. So I don't know what you're speaking about. So if you really can really sit aside, not here, somewhere, and explain better to us. Thank you.
No, Honorable Vada. You see, that's the problem of making statements instead of follow-up questions, because you then lose the follow-up question in the process. Is there any other follow-up question? Honorable Khai.
Yeah, thank you, Honorable Deputy Chairperson. I think firstly, we would like to invite Honorable Vavda to join the African National Congress so that we can teach him a dress code.
What is the follow-up question, Honorable Khai?
In the ANC.
Is there a follow-up question?
The follow-up question is on, in the past, the focus has always been on the cash compensation. And the minister, when he was introducing the second claim, indicated that the focus will be now on the restoration. To what extent are we achieving that, Deputy Minister? Thank you.
Deputy Minister?
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Definitely, we want to move away from the cash compensation because it doesn't really resemble the land that the people are looking at. We have introduced a program called redistribution of land, which even if you don't have a claim, but you can lease a land, the state land, so that you can operate and produce, and later on you can really have an ownership of that particular land. So I think we are looking forward to that. Our communities must understand that money cannot be kept like the land as it stands now. The land is not growing, but the population is growing. Thank you very much.
Any other follow-up question? Honorable Labaskafu.
Thank you, Chair. Minister, I would like to ask that during the 2013-14 financial year, 210 out of the 270 new land claims settled by the department were settled in the Western Cape, benefiting 5,709 beneficiaries from 1,202 families. How does the minister plan to speed up the land claim settlement processes in the other provinces of the Republic?
Honourable Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. We are really speeding up the issues of the land claim. That's why we are now opening the office of the Valuer General, so that the evaluation of the land must be speeded up and it must be done in-house. So I think that's how we thought, because our backlog is on the evaluation part. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Honorable Suka. You'll be the last one.
Ngifuna apha kusekela mphathiswa kule nkqubo yobuyiselwa imihlaba kubantu bawo. Kule nto yenkxolazwe ingaba urhulumente nabaxhamlayo kulo rhulumente wangaphambili bakhona abantu ingakumbi abamhlophe.
Just hold it, honorable. Is there no interpretation or a translation? Can we have translation, please?
Uthetha ulwimi lwam.
Is it okay? Can you proceed?
I don't know if he doesn't speak, I won't hear.
What channel is that? Oh, maybe proceed to Honorable Suka.
Yeah, ek sal vir meneer Lont verduidelik later. Maar op die oomblik ek wil my taal praat. Pansi kwalo mthetho wokubuyisela imihlaba. Ingakumbi kubantu bawo kweli limiyo lomdibaniso. Ndifuna uqonde into yokubana kwaba bexhamle kurhulumente wangaphambili. Ingaba bakhona noko ingakumbi abamhlophe. Abathi hayi rhulumente wexesha. Singakunika imihlaba ethile singayisebenzisiyo ukwenzela ubuncedise le nkqubo yobuyisela imihlaba kwakunye nezinto zawo kubantu bawo. Kuba le nto ingathi kwicalanye, ingathi lapha kuthi kurhulumente kuphela. Kanti le mihlaba siyifunayo iphesheya kwelinye icala lezintlanga zilapho. Zona zenza ntoni njengegalelo lokubana sivane kweli lizwe ngokukompensata kwabona le mihlaba apha kubantu bethu. Ingaba ikhona loo nkqubo? Kuba kaloku sayiphelisa i-willing buyer, willing seller. Kodwa ndicinga uba wonke umntu unegalelo, ayingorhulumente kuphela ekufuneka enzele le nkxamleko. Abelungu in particular, ikhona indima abayidlalayo ekubuyiseleni imihlaba kubantu bawo.
Deputy Minister.
Thank you very much, Chairperson. Definitely they are coming into play, and in most cases, all those landowners that their land are under claim, they come forward to the state so that they really present themselves as people who want to help in terms of keeping the production level at the same time, at the same level, while we are still dealing with the claim. And some of them, as I'm speaking to you now, they agree with their farm dwellers and they give them land so that the government can settle them and we can build, we are building agri-villages so that those people can really have access to the land next to their working place. So it is really happening, but it is not happening on the pace that we'll all accept. It's just here and there, and the rest are really still standing as they are standing. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. That brings us to the end of question on rural development and land reform. We now proceed to the questions on telecommunication and postal services. Question 212 by Honorable Zwane. Honorable Minister.
Thank you, Chairperson. The reply is as follows. The labor problems at South African Post Office are receiving our highest attention. To date, we have held numerous engagements with the board, or former board, the management, and the representative of the trade unions, with the aim of understanding the reasons behind the current industrial actions. These engagements have revealed that labor engagement forums at the South African Post Office had collapsed for several months. We then advised the management and labor to reestablish these formal forums of engagement. And to continue to engage with the aim of seeking solution and process all the matters that are dealt with in these forums. The first priority are the measures, all these stakeholders to have the measures to end the current industrial action. Secondly, it is tasked with ensuring that all the outstanding matters that impact on the labor relations and the sustainability of the organizations are addressed. We have directed SAPO to address the capacity challenges within the human resource environment and labor relations section as a matter of urgency. The labor disputes at SAPO centers on a number of issues, but there are many reasons for this, but the central issue is around the conversion of the casual workers into permanent position within the organization. The leadership of the unions and the management are engaged in the discussion, they've said, to ascertain how the conversion can be undertaken without jeopardizing the financial sustainability of the organization. That the financial situation has not improved, and indeed has been worsened by the industrial action, has led to inability to accelerate the conversion process, which in turn has resulted in further industrial action. At the center of these challenges also was that various agreements were entered into between the management and the unions within SAPO with regard to this process. It has also been alleged that non-implementation or selective implementation of these agreements has led to the current situation. It is important to say that at this stage, there is no union who has declared any dispute or strike with the South African Post Office. So the current industrial actions are unprotected. What has unfortunately happened, the violence and intimidation which is associated with this labor strike and has been of great concern to us. In line with the Prevention of Public Violence and Intimidation Act 139 of 1991, we'd like to say we've been working with the law enforcement agency to ensure that the industrial action should remain peaceful in terms of our law and constitution, and we strongly condemn the acts of intimidation and violence. The last portion of the question, to date, 190 cases have been reported to police. Most of them are in relation to intimidation and malicious damage to property. However, to date, there has been 17 arrests in relation to these cases, 10 of which are currently in court, and only 7 have been withdrawn. And we are also saying that SAPO, because we have noticed that they have not been implementing the principle of no work, no pay, we have then directed that SAPO must adhere to this principle. Just to give you a breakdown, Chairperson, in August we had 36 cases of these intimidation and actions. This increased in September to 74 and came down to 63 in October and 17 now in November. And some of these cases, they relate to cases such as abduction, armed robberies, assault, housebreaking, but majority of them are around intimidation and malicious damage to property, as we have said. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Honorable Minister, Honorable Zwane. Do you have any supplementary question?
No, thank you, Chairperson. I would like to appreciate the response given by the Minister. I think he has adequately addressed all the issues that I posed in the question. Thank you very much. We wish him all the best.
Thank you very much. Is there any supplementary question? Honorable Prince.
Chairperson, Honorable Minister.
Don't be shy.
Honorable Minister, I'd like to know if there is any plans in place to deal with the essential postal services during the strike.
Essential services or, I don't know.
Postal.
Postal services. Is there an alternative?
Yes, we have put measures to try and address the challenges. Let me just say the areas where we have had the heaviest impact is really around Gauteng, to a certain extent around Bloemfontein, Polokwane, and to a lesser extent Cape Town. Other postal service centers, they are functioning normally. But even in places like Gauteng, this week I visited Tswane Mail, one in Randburg, one in Westport, and one next to the airport. In most of the centers, the workers are starting to come back. If we check at Westport, for instance, which is our largest center, over 90% of the workers are back at work. If we check at Tswane, over 60% of the workers are back at work. But the challenge is still the small group which is going around in kumbis intimidating people. That's why we're working very close with. What we've also done, particularly with some of the major clients, we have created alternative venue for sorting. The biggest backlog at the moment is one which is at OR Tambo, because the challenge there, the post which comes from abroad, we must first verify that the declared VATs are correct and they pay the VAT and that the declared customs duties are correct. That's where the largest and huge backlog is at the moment. We believe that if workers can go back to work, we can be able to clear the backlog within 1 month to two months and clear the whole backlog and go to, into operations. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Honorable Minister. Is there any other supplementary question, Honorable Kaule?
Thank you, Honorable Chairperson. Honorable Minister, is there engagement with the tertiary institutions in respect of the grade 12 learners who might be greatly affected by the lack of communication in respect of applications between them and the institutions, so that at least alternative measures of conducting them in respect of progress is done so that they don't get affected by the beginning of the year? Thank you.
Yes, as we have said, as you are aware, that last week we appointed Dr. Lushaba as part of our intervention, and when we removed the board, or when the board resigned. This team, this intervention team, part of its task is of stabilization is to engage key stakeholders, like the tertiary institutions, and but our sense is that it's not of much of a problem with the tertiary institutions because they can communicate using other electronic means. The problem really lies where there's distance education like UNISA and other. That's where we're trying to deal with backlog. The other huge problem is small businesses who rely on publications which they do through the post office. They are severely affected, and these are small companies or family companies which are really suffering. And the other area of we are trying to say we must deal with as a matter of agency, the distribution of medicine, particularly for the sick and the elderly. The, why we're so concerned about those who are dealing with distance education, like in UNISA and other colleges, is that these are people who come from the poor sections of our society. And people who are struggling while they are working, they are trying to improve their lives. It's a working class. So those are the type of engagements we have been having with the leaders of the or representative of these workers to say, while we have to deal with the issues which are legitimate, which are raised by the workers themselves about the conditions of their employment, but we must make sure that the company survives and is delivering the services and restore the credibility of the South African post office to the greater public which we are serving. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Honorable Mtilen. Will be the last one.
Thanks. I just want to pose this question to the minister. How far has the department gone in as far as the disappearance of 21 billion earmarked for SAPO in this 2013-2014 financial year?
I'm not aware of the 21 billion which has been lost in this current financial year. We have not tabled the financial result even for last year. The matter of 21 billion was in the 2012-2013 Act. If you check the reports, it was handled then. It's about 2 years back. No, that's correct, because we have looked into the matter. We have not had any 10 to 2.1 billion loss this financial year. Let me also say, even that reported amount of irregular spending, the current investigation by the SIU, it goes across the span of 10 years period. So all those, if the money was stolen, the SIU will discover, and those who are responsible for that, they then have to face the law. So there'll be no stone unturned for those who have their fingers in the kitty. But let's all be patient for the SIU. I'm in constant contact with them to say, we really appreciate if they can finalize those investigations, because that's what will help us also as we put a new turnaround to say what lessons can we learn in dealing with this important state-owned company. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That was the last supplementary question. We then now proceed to question 213. Honorable Deputy Minister.
Thank you, Chairperson. The reply is as follows. In relation to the Post Bank, both the legislative and policy mandates are designed to create the conditions of a strong Post Bank whose task is to serve the citizens of South Africa. In particular, the Post Bank is enjoined to ensure that there is financial inclusion and of the disadvantaged communities. The measures we are putting currently, the first one, in order to expedite the licensing, because we have to apply for a banking license from the Reserve Bank. We have teams which involves our officials from our department and National Treasury who are assisting the management of the post office to make sure that we comply as soon as possible. While we're dealing with the license application, we are simultaneously with the dealing with the fit and proper assessments, because the board members of a new corporatized bank will have to meet the fit and proper test. So we have submitted the names of the suggested board members, and they are undergoing that fit and proper test currently. So those are the measures which are in place so that we can have the Post Bank being a full bank and as a bank of the people with a developmental mandate. I thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Honorable Mamburu. Do you have any supplementary question?
Thank you very much, Deputy Chairperson. Minister, with more than 2,000 post office outlets and to more than 1.8 million savers, what benefits is there?
They can have savings, they can have loans, and they can also swipe like in any other bank. They can use internet as we're rolling out internet to the rural areas. But the aim is really to make sure that the unbanked and the unserved areas do have the banking services throughout the country, so that we can really make and transfer those people who are operating in the second economy to the mainstream economy of the country. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Is there any other supplementary question? Honorable Hai, please, no afterthought. Do we have any other supplementary questions besides Honorable Hai? Fine. Honorable Hai?
No, my question is on whether the department has plans to encourage departments to use Post Bank as a bank of choice, including the payment of social grants and payment to the civil servants and parliamentarians. Thank you.
Honourable Minister.
Thank you. Yes, we do have these plans. And as we have said publicly, that if we can have just the government courier business, not the whole of it, just 10% of your courier business as parliament, that and as government as a whole, that will remove all the financial challenges of the post office, because they face the challenge of declining mail volumes. In terms of the bank, the post bank, that's why it is true, the access to the majority of the people, that's what drives us to say we need this bank. If we can deliver the pension or the grants we are delivering so that people can have them every day and in a reliable manner with vibrant IT systems, that will change the economy in the rural areas. People won't have to wait until month end or after 2 months so that they can access their pensions. But if you can just make sure that we are able to pay not even all public servants, and I'll prefer that all of you, including the honorable members, with presence in every postal outlet, so that people can access the government services in general through the modern means of internet and technology, so that the post office will become the buzz of the community. As we also roll out these broadband services, we want to create free Wi-Fi points at the post office so that those who can't afford to buy data, but they can still access the internet and help grow their business through the internet, through those Wi-Fi. So that's the approach as we move to sustainable post office, which can stand on its own without coming to every year to ask for a grant from government. Thank you.
Thank you very much. That gives us then opportunity to proceed to the next question, 220. Honorable Masango. Honorable
Minister. In terms of challenges, we have just mentioned one. There are several challenges which are facing the post office. The first is ongoing leadership challenge at both management and board level, which has been happening for a very long time. Last Friday, we announced that the post office has been placed under some intervention, which is led by Dr. Lushaba in terms of the Postal Act, Section 25, in order to stabilize the company and address all the challenges that are facing the company in the next 3 months. The second problem is the problems of around maladministration. And as I said, we hope that there are two investigations by the SIU at the post office will assist us in trying to identify the root causes of this problem and bring to an end to these irregularities. The third issue is the unstable or sometimes hostile labor environment, and which was largely attributed to the lack of appropriate management of the system of the casualization of the people who are under the labor broker system. And this has really led to these sporadic industrial actions, which are often protected, as we have said. And the labor forum, which we have reestablished, is busy addressing this matter right now. Over and above these challenges, SAPO is faced with a problem of the declining mail volumes. It's not a unique problem to South Africa, it's happening elsewhere. And in this respect, that's why we're saying we need a strategy of how SAPO is going to modernize so that it remain competitive as a logistic company, particularly in the postal sector and the logistics sector. And as we have said, we're engaging with our officials and National Treasury, and Dr. Lushaba has given a specific there is instruction to prioritize the turnaround strategy so that we can sign off this, the turnaround strategy. But for this turnaround strategy, we need the buy-in of the workers. That's why we have said they must consult all the workers, because it can only work when there's an effective buy-in of all of our workers. Those are some of the major challenges which are faced by the South African Post Office currently. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are you still standing in for Honourable Masang?
Thank you, Deputy Chairperson. When will a striking South African Post Office employees resume their duties? B, stability at the executive leadership level be achieved? And C, the annual financial statements be finalized?
Honourable Minister.
I've already communicated that we're engaging with the workers. As a minister, I can't force the people to go and work. It involves negotiations. Sorry, I must look at you. My apologies.
No, it's okay.
I think I feel better if I look at you. It involves negotiations. That's why the first task, when you realize that there was no forum for engagement, there was a complete breakdown of this forum for engagement between management and workers. We then directed that this must be reestablished. All the workers were happy with that, and the management is really trying to make this effective. Dr. Lushaba's intervention will also have to look at that, because it's the first term of reference that stabilized the post office, even including the in terms of the finances, let me reiterate, the post office is not bankrupt. It's got a cash flow problem. So we have mandated the intervention team to look at the capacity on management of finances, and if there's no capacity, and go and get that capacity as a matter of agency, because we can't run a 6-7 billion company if there's no adequate financial skills to drive the company. The financial statements, it is one of the terms of reference that in the next 2 or 3 months, we must finalize the financial statements so that we can have an AGM, so that we can then table the report to the parliament. So those are the priorities which are within the intervention team itself. All what I'll appeal, we're appealing to all to support the intervention, allowed to do it so that we don't do what the post office has been doing all along, where you have knee-jerk reaction to every problem you're confronting. The biggest problem with the management was that they were signing agreements with small groups of people, and then tomorrow they sign another agreement without implementing this agreement, because you don't just resolve the labor dispute by signing agreement. You must know that when you sign, you'll be capable to implement that agreement. So that's what we are doing now. And as I've said, in terms of Support Act Section 25, we've got 3 months for that intervention and to produce the results. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Is there any supplementary question? In the absence of any, we then proceed to the next question by Honorable Mokoena. Honorable Minister.
Question number 231.
Yes, 231.
the reply is as follows. Yes, there are some challenges, as I said, within the financial management in the post office which are addressing now. As I've said, the major and the current problem is that one of the cash flow management. Maybe just to explain how this cash flow problem is happening. The SAPO, they sign contracts that if they are creditors, they must pay them within a month. But those who are owing SAPO, they can pay a month up to 2 months. So the flow of money doesn't really talk to each other. Those are some of the fundamental things. It's not that money is being stolen every month. So it's to rebalance the type of cash flows, because you can't pay your expenses in 2 weeks, but your the people who are owing you, they've given 2 months to pay you. So those are some of the things which we're really addressing. Some of the challenges in the finances pertain to the long problem, as we have said, that they were declaring the subsidy as a profit for many years. And the parliament and you, honorable members, you have been warning the organization they shouldn't do that. Now that we have removed the subsidy 2 years ago, there's a sudden collapse. There are no more profits and so on. So we're saying they must report correctly and they must monitor their finances quite frequently. As I've said also, in relation to maladministration, we've got the SIU investigation, which is going on. But the real problem, really problem, was caused by the labor broker system and the management of SAPO, because while they were employing this casual, they were no more filling the permanent position. The casuals were filling, they were casual, permanent casual, but under the labor brokers. And that gives rise to what the workers are talking about now, equal job for equal pay for equal job challenge. And the management of this problem, we're saying we must have a comprehensive management. We must have an agreement by all the unions on how are we going to absorb these workers as much as quick as we can. And because we believe, Chairperson, that as we increase the business of SAPO, there'll be need for more and more and more employees in the SAPO other than cutting down the jobs. So that's the situation we're facing at the moment. The current arrangement is that when there's national attrition, we must consider those casual workers. When the finances of SAPO allow to create new posts, we must consider them first in filling those posts. And the last question is a little bit disconnect. Chairperson, subsection 3, he asks us whether we're investigating the cases. It's like a separate question altogether. Of mobile operators giving the market companies personal information. We say no, there's no current investigation by the department. However, the Electronic Communication and Transaction Act of 2002 provides that any person who collects or stores personal information must have the express written permission from the owner of the information before they can disclose it to third parties, unless he or she is permitted or required to do so by a law. The consumers need to also be cautioned when signing mobile phone contracts. Often, clauses in small print give operators permission to distribute customers' personal information to third parties. So, honorable members, I know most of you have got contracts. Be very careful. Don't be excited by the smartphone and the beautiful phone. Read the fine print, because that's where you sometimes give this permission. Penalties for breaking the provisions of the Electronic Communications Transaction Act are a fine or imprisonment for a period not exceeding 12 months. So it's up to this House to see whether these penalties are small or relevant or not. It's up to Parliament to decide. There are other pieces of legislation that provide for the protection of the consumer's personal information. So customers need to be aware of them and need to use them to protect themselves against this. So our task is to make awareness campaigns to the public, particularly when they are signing these contracts with these service providers, that they must be careful, but we'll be also cautioning the service providers that they must not abuse our people. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. But I'm sure equally so, Minister, that part of the question must have reminded you of your previous life. Because these are some of the things that you used to try and sensitize South Africa about. All right. Is there any supplementary question? In the absence of any supplementary question, therefore, all right, therefore there are two announcements. One is that dinner is arranged at the old assembly. I think it was in anticipation that we might leave here at 8 o'clock. But to avoid wasteful expenditure, seeing that we are finished now before 8 o'clock. And then members are also requested to remain at least just for 5 minutes. There's a briefing from the chief whip. Then, honorable members, that concludes the business of the day, and the house is adjourned.